Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. Today, I'll show you the beginnings of my Trolls AI. Last week, I added a server-spawned troll to my game. A troll on its own is not that much fun if it doesn't interact at all, so today I'm going to show you how I made the troll attack the player. I'll start by explaining the exact behaviour I'm going to implement. I'll then walk through a few of the technical changes I needed to make to support those behaviours. And lastly, I'll demo everything and talk a bit about what's coming up. My goal for this episode was to make the troll attack the player. I'm not ready to implement pathfinding in the server yet, so for now, the troll is going to need to stay stationary. And it might seem a stationary AI that deals damage to the player should be a trivial task, but it has quite a few moving parts to consider. I want the troll to only deal damage to the player if they get within the troll's reach. I want the troll's attack to operate on a cooldown to prevent the player from getting spammed with attacks. I want the client to show the troll attacking and play sounds and things, but still want the server to be controlling that stuff without extending the communication protocol any more than needed. I need the AI code itself to be stateless. In any given tick, I want it to read any state it needs from the entity store, then apply any changes it needs to the entity's components. On the next tick, some other copy of the AI service might then pick up where the first one left off. Lastly, I want to avoid sending the troll's AI state to the player. Although this AI is mostly deterministic, I don't want it to be possible to develop hacks that can see what the various AIs are thinking. So I made a start on implementing my AI. I first created yet another service that I called the ticker service. On each tick, it will query the entity service for entities containing components of interest, then run functions over those entities. It's a bit like the update function in Unity, I suppose, but upside down or inside out or something. It's here the AI will live for now. I'm not worrying about scalability yet, but in time, I'll want this to be parallelizable. The system will endeavor to deliver each interesting component to a single ticker instance on every tick. I was beginning to get a lot of code repetition between all these services, so I started by factoring out the common stuff like helmet, terminus, service configuration, and error handling code. I have a couple of services needing the concept of ticks now, so I factored that out too. It led to the boilerplate ticker service being really simple. It just asks the common utility to create a service and configures it to call a method on each tick. The tick frequency can be configured in a YAML file. I set that to 1 Hz while I'm developing, but I expect it to be at least 10 Hz for the real game. I went and ported the entity service across to the new common infrastructure too. I then extended it to allow entities to be queried by component, and also to find entities based on their location. This is going to be super important for the AI. We globally need to find all the mobs needing AI processing, and for each one, we're going to need to find nearby players. To support querying by location, I also extended the current entity schema to support the UVQRY voxel coordinate system I developed in episodes 12 and 13. I allow the caller to specify a center hex coordinate and a hex range. For simplicity, I made the database itself just support querying at the chunk level. The entity service is responsible for making sure it requests enough chunks and filters out any objects outside the specified range. I modified the UDP transmitter service to hide any components or attributes starting with a hash symbol. This is a simple way of preventing clients from seeing internal data like the AI state. The ticker service then looks for any entities with a hash agent component, checks that its behavior is aggro, then passes the entity into the actual AI function. The AI function starts by finding all player entities within detection range. In addition to its hash agent component, the troll also needs to maintain some other state, so I added a hash agent.state component, which starts out empty. Based on this agent state, if the troll is currently targeting a player, then it considers going passive if they're out of range. If the troll isn't aggressive against a player and a player is detected, then it targets that player. If the target is within attack range, then it executes an attack. 3 things happen when an attack occurs. Some damage is done to the player, the cooldown timer is set, and a client action component is added to the troll to notify the client that it needs to play a sound and animation. If the player is not in front of the troll, then it gradually turns to face the player. I really need to put some effort into refactoring much of this code. Sending updates to the entity service is really verbose and can be pretty error-prone. The ticker service also makes a separate pass over any entities with a client action component in order to clean up any stale entries and prevent them from hanging around forever. They only need to be there long enough to notify nearby clients at the time. The actual process of getting the AI to this point was of course a lot less linear than I've shown here. I know a lot of you are interested in finding out more about the process I follow when developing and seeing the traps I fall into along the way. Well, good news, I'm now streaming most weekdays at 12:30 UTC on both Twitch and YouTube. These streams are also available in my dev stream playlist on YouTube. There's already a great community building up around the streams, so be sure to check it out if that's your kind of thing. I send out notifications on Discord and Twitter at the start of each stream, so be sure to join the Discord or follow me on Twitter to know when I go live. Links are in the description below. Moving on to the client, there wasn't a huge amount that needed to be done to get things kind of working for this episode. It's all a bit hacky, but that's often the best way when you're starting out on a series of changes and don't know where things are heading. I was originally ignoring updates from the server for the player entity, since the client had been the source of truth for player data until now. I modified it to accept other non-positional updates from the server. When it sees a health component come through, it syncs its own survival component with it so the player can see their hit points. For other entities, when it sees a client action component come through, it pulls up the entity's audio source and animation components and plays sounds and animations appropriate to the type of action. I'll likely need to add a more complex timing system in here to allow the sound and animation to better sync up, but this will work for now. The client stores the ID of the action it has just played, so it doesn't worry about playing it again. Right now, the list of completed actions will grow indefinitely, which is definitely not good. I'm not too worried about it though, because this will get fixed once the UDP transmitter service is further along. It doesn't yet notify the client when components are removed from entities, which would allow the client to clean up too. And here's the end result. If we get too close to the troll, he will attack us and do damage. He's not very smart though, so if you can keep behind him, he will keep turning to face you, but never be able to get a strike in. Before I get into what's coming up next, don't forget to give this episode a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. If you didn't enjoy it, be sure not to subscribe, so you can miss out on seeing me make further progress on my combat system. If you want a recap of how I built my scalable game server, I covered it across three episodes, starting with episode 15. There's a card on the screen now. Next episode, I'm aiming to have the server-controlled troll chase after the player. I've seen a lot of comments from people who think this is where my stateless server-side architecture will begin to fail. So I, for one, am interested to see how it goes. That wraps up this episode of the Devlog. So until next time, happy game developing!